When I was in first grade, I learned 1 + 1 = 2. When I was in second grade, I learned 4 × 4 = 16. When I was in high school, I never really learned algebra. But beyond that was trigonometry and all these other higher science math courses. So there's different levels of math. And in a similar vein, there are different levels of understanding and interpreting the scripture. And our gospel reading today gives us a great opportunity to explore some different levels of meaning in this reading, which comes from the gospel according to John, chapter 12, verses 20 through 33. And I invite you now to listen for the word of God. Now among those who went up to worship at the festival were some Greeks. They came to Philip, who was from Bethsaida in Galilee, and said to him, "Sir, we wish to see Jesus." Philip went and told Andrew, then Andrew and Philip went and told Jesus. Jesus answered them, "The hour has come for the Son of Man to be glorified. Very truly I tell you, unless a grain of wheat falls into the earth and dies, it remains just a single grain. But if it dies, it bears much fruit. Those who love their life lose it, and those who hate their life in this world will keep it for eternal life. Whoever serves me must follow me, and where I am, there will my servant be also. Whoever serves me, the Father, will honor. Now my soul is troubled. And what should I say? Father, save me from this hour? No. It is for this reason that I have come to this hour. Father, glorify your name." Then a voice came from heaven. "I have glorified it, and I will glorify it again." And the crowd standing there heard it and said it was thunder. Others said an angel has spoken to him. Jesus answered, "This voice has come for your sake, not for mine. Now is the judgment of this world. Now the ruler of this world will be driven out. And I, when I am lifted up from the earth, will draw all people to myself." He said this to indicate the kind of death he was to die. The word of the Lord for us today. Thanks be to God. In silence, let us pray to the Lord. Amen. We come to the place in the gospel where Jesus is looking ahead to the events of what we now know as Holy Week. Jesus is anticipating what will happen to him when he goes to Jerusalem. And so, naturally, we read in verse 27, "Now my soul is troubled." We tend to forget the aspect of Jesus is that he was fully human. And so, of course, his soul was troubled, as he anticipated the suffering and the death that lay before him. "And what should I say?" he said. "Father, Save me from this hour? No. For this reason I have come to this hour. So that's where Jesus is contemplating the events of Holy Week, of Passion Week, of suffering and death, when suddenly a voice from heaven came and said, I have glorified my name, and I will glorify it again. Notice then the three different levels of interpretation presented in the text here. The crowd standing there heard it and said that it was thunder. They couldn't deny they heard something. It sounded to them like thunder, a rumble. We've all experienced the sound of thunder. This is the kind of revelation that is known in theology as general revelation. There are some things we can know about God just from nature, from thunder, from rain, from beautiful days such as the last few days we've had. We know that God must be creative, God must be generative, God must be artistic and benevolent and loving, because all the world seems to be singing in nature. But on the other hand, what do we do with the hurricane that blows through and destroys homes and lives? What does that tell us about God? You see, general revelation has limitations. It leaves us unclear as to the true nature of God. So that's the level that the crowd was operating on, general revelation. They heard the thunder. They couldn't make out any more than that. In the second level, others said, an angel has spoken to him. They heard the sound, and what they heard in the sound was an angel, a messenger from God. And they could tell that the messenger from God had some kind of message. It was given to Jesus. He could understand it. They couldn't understand it. This is the level of understanding that we might say is of the Western Orthodox Christianity. In other words, it's all on Jesus. We're going to trust in Jesus to tell us what God is saying, to do God's work for us. We emphasize the divinity of Jesus. God has this direct connection with God that we can never have. But then there is a third level of interpretation that I want you to listen for here. Jesus answered, this voice has come for your sake, not for mine. So Jesus didn't need to hear a voice from God from heaven speaking to him. He heard the voice of God from within. He was in constant communication with God. So the voice from heaven didn't come for Jesus. It came for the people. But now Jesus is going to tell them what the voice said in very clear language. And if you notice, this is an apocalyptic setting. We've heard a voice from heaven. It sounds like thunder. And now Jesus is about to give this apocalyptic utterance, which is God's message to the people. And here's the message. Now is the judgment of this world. Now the ruler of this world will be driven out. We've taken that in our Western Orthodox Christianity, and we've interpreted it to mean that Jesus is speaking out against the systems of this world, because Jesus' kingdom, his realm, is not of this world. What system is he speaking out against? He's speaking out against a system that's based on violence, a system where my name's right, a system where he who dies with the most toys wins. That's the system Jesus is speaking against. And so we're driven to reach out and to help bring, as Jesus said, thy kingdom be done on earth as it is in heaven. We work for justice in the world. And that is definitely a valid interpretation. But I also want you to hear here the possibility of the Eastern Orthodox Christian interpretation of this text. Because the way that they would hear this is when Jesus says, now is the judgment of this world. Now the ruler of this world will be driven out. They would say Jesus here is talking about you and about me and about our lives and our experiences of God. Jesus is telling us that the ruler of our lives is going to have to be driven out. Now, what in the world could that mean? Well, the Apostle Paul referred to this concept as sarx, S-A-R-X, the flesh, our human, our animal nature, you might say. It must be driven out so that Jesus then can fill it, or so that the Christ within us already can grow out and fill that space up. Thomas Merton helped us to understand what this concept would mean when he said, this is Jesus talking about the false self. The false self, meaning the mask that we wear around in public every day, where I'm going to be looking my best and on my best behavior and presenting myself to you in the best light I possibly can, even though you're able to see all my faults that I can't see myself. And of course, the same goes with you and with me. We have these false selves that we present that really are not our true selves. Our true selves is ourselves on the level of our soul. The selves that we have that are on the level of eternity. Those are the selves that Jesus wants to ignite. There was a spiritual master who had some disciples. And the disciples were complaining to the master, saying, it's just impossible to follow you, because you anytime we try to really nail down what God is or what this is we're trying to do here with you, you always want to just brush that aside. You don't ever want to just nail anything down, and we don't have anything to hang on to. And the master said, you're right. You don't have anything to hold on to. Especially when you're the little bird up in the bird's nest, and the mother bird finally pushes you out of the nest, even though you can't yet fly. And so you're falling, you're flapping, trying to keep from dying when you hit the ground. That, he said, is faith. Here in the bird's nest, we have our beliefs. We're comfortable with God. This is where we like to be. But there comes a point when God pushes us out of that nest and we're falling and we have to learn to fly. That is faith. Faith is not what you know. Faith is by definition what you don't know. If you know it, it can't be faith. Now, Jesus talks about the same concept with a different image here in verse 24. Jesus says, "Very truly, I tell you, unless a grain of wheat falls into the earth and dies, it remains a single grain of wheat." So if I have in my hand a single grain of wheat, and it stays in my hand, it will always remain a single grain of wheat. But if I reach down into the ground and dig a little hole with my hand, and put the seed in it, and cover it up with dirt until the little grain of wheat dies from lack of sunshine and air, then, says Jesus, it may bear much fruit. Again, Jesus talking about the death of our false selves, enabling the birth of our true selves, which causes the fruit of the Spirit to grow in our life. Love, joy, peace, patience, kindness, gentleness, self-control. Those are the fruits of the Spirit that God wants to draw to grow in our lives. This whole idea of having to die to be reborn is addressed quite well in Richard Rohr's book, Falling Upward, A Spirituality for the Second Half of Life. But it's also addressed quite dramatically by Jesus himself. Because as I said at the beginning, he's facing here the cross, which is where he will die. But he refers to that as the place where he will be glorified, where he will draw all people to him. It's true for us, as it was true for Christ. Our false self has to die for our true self to be reborn. And it's true for our congregation that we've come to the time where God is pushing us out of the nest, and we're about to fall. And we're going to be flapping and flapping and flapping until we learn to fly. And that is when, with God's help, we are going to soar in faith. That's the vision God has for this church. And that's the vision that we are living into. It's an exciting vision. It's a Spirit-filled vision. And it will be exciting to watch unfold. Thanks be to God. Amen.